Now that we have established why governments exist, we are going to build some depth on each of its functions. Today's lesson is all about what justice is and how we can apply it. I'm Pragmatic Penguin. Let's get to it. Since the beginning of political philosophy with Socrates, the question of what justice is has plagued the subject. While it is a long and fascinating history, it's not necessary to understand the whole of it to get to the point, because the debate has a lot to do with where the philosophers start. Socrates takes a top-down approach, observing society and determining justice for the individuals through that lens. Utilitarians take an ends approach, determining justice by the end state. And social contract theorists take an origins approach, determining justice by what is necessary to escape the state of nature. In answering the question of why government exists, I use the approach of the contract theorist because that is the one based most in reality rather than abstraction. It makes no sense to change that course now. The theorist whose approach is summarized in this video is the American political philosopher John Rawls, and from his book, A Theory of Justice. Now imagine yourself in a room of people, except you have no knowledge of your own particulars. Your skills, your intellect, your health, your age, your education are all unknown to you. But you do understand the general, and you understand people. This is what Rawls terms the original position, and this lack of knowledge is termed the veil of ignorance. From this original position, as opposed to the state of nature, you are capable of envisioning not merely a preferable society, but a perfect society. Your stake in this discussion is that you will then be plunged into the society, and since you do not know your own particulars, it is clear that you may be the worst off of all people within the society. Now, it is also possible you may be the best off in this society. But instead of focusing on that, you would want to hedge your bets and create a society that you would be willing to live even if you were in the bottom 1% of it. This is a self-interested approach, which comes most natural to humans. Here is where we begin. We start with the things that are unacceptable no matter their probability. Things which everyone in society will be promised no matter their wealth. This gives us personal sovereignty, or what is more commonly referred to as liberty. Now, society changes liberty, but it doesn't necessarily diminish it. While you are no longer free to murder, you are free from murder, at least systematically. The same for all other violent crimes, and this is because the goal switches from allowing you absolute freedom to securing you from the freedom of others, which gives you the maximum possible value of freedom, no matter how rich or poor you are. Now, it's important to understand that liberties are traded. Sometimes they come into conflict with each other. When we have to decide which liberty triumphs over the other, this is where we fall back to our values. The common example here would be the case of yelling fire in a crowded movie theater where there is none. This act could cause a panic and result in harm to any given person in the room, all for one person's freedom to speak. Since this speech brings about violence and infringes on others' personal sovereignty, this is an unacceptable action. The press is free to publish for whatever purpose it pleases, unless that purpose is to incite violence, because, once again, violence is a violation of person's sovereignty. Sovereignty here being defined as the right to self-governance, and with regards to violence, referring to the physical body. Now, is a society that values personal sovereignty and trades liberty only for liberty really all you need to feel comfortable jumping right in? Have you done everything in both an intelligent and rational way to assure yourself the best possible position in this society? Not quite. This society, if left by itself, would be vastly unequal. While there is a chance that you could be absurdly wealthy, there is a much better chance that you could wind up completely impoverished. Is abolishing inequality the answer? Probably not. Humans have a lot of variety. Some are athletic, some are brilliant, some are hardworking, some are pretty, and some are just plain unlucky. And that's a bit of the point. You see, the person behind the veil of ignorance, that's us before luck is applied. Our attributes are a result of luck. Right place, right time, right circumstances, right household, and right parents. These aren't things you get to choose, and when you do make the choice, it's because you were lucky enough to be in a position to do so. We aren't entitled to our gifts, we're lucky. But by not rewarding these gifts, we aren't realizing their potential and failing to capitalize on the non-zero-sumness we all gathered to create. While inequality isn't pretty, it must exist to improve the general welfare. The question is, how? We make it conditional. Since the worst off in society are closest to the state of nature, they should receive reward for participating in a structure which they are ultimately the bottom of. In other words, inequality should exist for the benefit of the least advantaged members of society. Though this is to the benefit of all, since society is much safer when people are least desperate. Remember, we want to give ourselves the best chance at the best life. $100 to a person who earns $1 million a year is significantly less than $100 to a person who earns $1,000. So we want a system that redistributes some of that wealth accordingly. Not too much, so that gift sharing is disincentivized, but enough so that the worst positions avoid being in a similar place as they would be in the state of nature, since that is what we all agreed to leave. So the question now is, what about liberty? Can we trade liberty to benefit the least advantaged? The answer is no. We can never trade liberty for anything other than liberty, as that has a negative sum impact on the entirety of society. Humans are born to be free, and society should serve to give all of them an advantage in this regard. This is what we call a lexical order, and that the first condition must be met for the second to be applied, and the first is untouched at that point. This is a basic outline of justice as fairness. In this video, we took the issue of justice and applied the concepts of the original position and veil of ignorance to determine two rules for how justice can be applied to society. The first is to preserve liberty as much as possible, and the second is to allow for inequality as long as it is to the benefit of the least advantaged. With this, we can now communicate much more effectively about actions that are just or unjust in our society, and hopefully better address them. If you made it to the end of this video, I just wanted to say thank you for watching. If you enjoyed what you saw, please like and comment your thoughts down below. And don't forget to subscribe and hit that bell so you never miss out on more content just like this.